Brothers and sisters, we are continuing our series on the nature and character of God. We are on part five already, or maybe I got that wrong. I think maybe part six. Regardless, we're on the next part of the nature and character of God, and today we are looking at God's omniscience, his all-knowingness. We're going to talk a little bit about what that means, what all-knowingness means, and what it doesn't mean to. But we're also, much more importantly, going to be looking at the scriptures and what God's omniscience means for us, as well as what it means for how we ought to behave. But as always, we want to give a shout out to Karen Sorey from the Infographics Bible, the creator of the Infographics Bible, and thank her for allowing me to recreate this image and just appreciate that that work. Now, like I mentioned, we are looking at the nature and character of God, and we are looking at God's omniscience. And as we zoom in on that, once again, we want to remind ourselves that, as always, God's omniscience, all of his characteristics and attributes, are found within the context of the reality that God is love and the reality that God is holy and perfect. Nothing changes those things, and they indeed are part of the framework in which we find all of the other characteristics of God. And so today we are going to look at 1 John chapter 3 verses 19 to 24, in which we read these words: "This is how we know that we belong to the truth, and how we set our hearts at rest in his presence. If our hearts condemn us, we know that God is greater than our hearts, and he knows everything." Dear friends, if our hearts do not condemn us, we have confidence before God and receive from him anything we ask, because we keep his commands and do what pleases him. And this is his command: to believe in the name of his Son, Jesus Christ, and to love one another as he commanded. The one who keeps God's commands lives in him, and he in them. And this is how we know that he lives in us. We know it by the Spirit he gave us. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Amen. Amen. Well, there are a couple of important notes that we need to make about that passage before we carry on too far into this thing. We need to unpack a little bit what John is saying, because it's maybe a little bit convoluted for us, maybe something that doesn't immediately go, oh yeah, maybe it does for you. Regardless, we need to note that what John is saying is, whether our hearts condemn us or not, regardless of how our hearts feel, regardless of how our conscience feels, we know that God is greater than our hearts. And further, we know that God knows us intimately and exactly. So, in other words, if John is saying, if God knows us so well and God does not condemn us, then surely we cannot condemn ourselves either. In fact, John goes on to say that we ought to then have confidence in God, and confidence that we are not condemned and that God will give us whatever we ask. Now, that is very tricky, right? Because there's a temptation to say, yes, God is going to give me a Ferrari. I'm going to ask him because I know God didn't condemn me. So I'm going to ask God for a Ferrari. And to be fair, there may be times when asking for a Ferrari is exactly what God desires for us. But if we read further on, we see that the key thing is that we are obedient to God's commands, which is to love God, basically, John is saying, to love God with all our heart, mind, soul, and strength, and to love our neighbor as ourselves. John means that God will give us whatever we ask, insofar as what we ask for fits with what God desires for us too. What God commands us to do and what God has designed us to do. Secondly, we need to remember that faith through the Holy Spirit is key. This is how we know that we belong to the truth and how we set our hearts at rest in His presence. We know it by the Spirit He gave us. See, this is really important because I know a lot of people, including myself sometimes, who have a temptation for their consciences to run away with guilt and condemnation. And sometimes that is a direct attack from Satan. Sometimes that is based in what we are hearing from other people, or sometimes it's based in the mental pathways that we have built up over years, right? But John says, no, we should be in a place where we can be at rest in God's presence, where we do not need to be any longer like Isaiah when he first is confronted by God in visions. And Isaiah says, woe to me, for I am a man of unclean lips and I come from a people of unclean lips. No. We, just like Isaiah, did not any longer have to be that way after he had been cleansed with the fiery coal, so too we who have been cleansed by the blood of Jesus, we no longer need to be crying out, woe is me, because we can come and be at peace in God's presence. But we only know that by faith. We only know that by faith through the Holy Spirit. And that's really important because as we go along, we're going to talk about human knowledge and what that is and what it isn't. And it's important to remember that really the most important things that we know come from faith that is given to us by God through the power of the Holy Spirit working in us. Well, there are a couple of different ways that omniscience is perceived in the Bible, or rather how the implications for people as they understand or as they come to understand God's all-knowingness. One way is that many times God's all-knowingness, His omniscience, can be perceived as a threat, right? Not that God is maliciously hunting us down, but rather that it's awfully intimidating and downright terrifying for the God who expects perfection to know infinitely and intimately every single fault and flaw and sin that is within us. That is terrifying. Even those of us who follow Jesus or try to follow Jesus in our daily lives, we still have a temptation to pretend like the stuff that's going on in my head and in my heart is somehow private. But it is not. It is not private. God knows every little thing that goes on in yours or my hearts and minds. And that can be terrifying, especially when God's standards are so high. And we can see this in these various Bible passages. Listen to Proverbs chapter 15, verse 3. The eyes of the Lord are everywhere, keeping watch on the wicked and the good. Ooh, right? Woe, this is Isaiah 29, verses 15 to 16. Woe to those who go to great depths to hide their plans from the Lord, who do their work in darkness and think, who sees us? Who will know? You turn things upside down as if the potter were thought to be like the clay. Shall what is formed say to the one who formed it, you did not make me? Can the pot, say to the potter, you know nothing? Right? Hebrews chapter 4 in the New Testament, chapter 4, verse 13. Nothing in all creation is hidden from God's sight. Everything is uncovered and laid bare before the eyes of him to whom we must give account. The thought of it is terrifying. Never in the history of the world has there ever been or ever will be, except for Jesus Christ, a judge on that level. People have a tendency to try and pretend like they're good people. They say, well, I'm a good person. I probably did more good things than bad things throughout. But part of what they're missing is that God knows everything, every little detail. And the second thing that they're missing is that God's not okay with just a little bit more good than bad. God is only okay with absolute perfection. And you put those two things together, and it is mind-numbingly terrifying. Psalm 139, verses 7 to 12, says this. Where can I go from your spirit? Where can I flee from your presence? If I say, surely the darkness will hide me, even the darkness will not be dark to you. The night will shine like the day, for darkness is as light to you. But there is another aspect to omniscience too. And that is a comforting aspect. Listen to what Jesus teaches his disciples and his followers in Matthew chapter 6, verses 3 to 4. But when you give to the needy, Jesus says, do not let your left hand know what your right hand is doing, so that your giving may be in secret. Then your Father, who sees what is done in secret, will reward you. Jesus goes on and then says, but when you pray, go into your room, close the door, and pray to your Father who is unseen. Then your Father who sees what is done in secret will reward you. And when you pray, do not keep on babbling like the pagans, for your Father knows what you need before you ask him. See, we have a God who not only knows all the wickedness in our hearts, but we also have a God who knows all of our needs. Who knows all that we do that is good, and who rewards those good things. And not only does God know these things, but he also works to use the knowledge that he has to our benefit. Listen to what Job says. Job, who was put through the ringer by Satan. Job, he says, but he, that is God, knows the way that I take. When he has tested me, I will come out as gold. You see, Job knows what God is doing. He doesn't understand all the reasons for it, but he is confident that what God is doing will refine him. And though it is a fire that hurts and is deeply painful, even full of anguish, he will come out as gold. The Bible also continues to say in Psalm 34, verse 15, that the eyes of the Lord are on the righteous, and his ears are attentive to their cry. We do not have a God who is aloof and who remains distant, who doesn't care about what we want or what we need. God is listening to us, and he hears us, and he sees us, and he is attentive to our cry. Now, you may look at these two sort of pictures, the threat and the comfort, and you may think, oh, Pastor Dan, we're in this contradictory territory again. Is God's omniscience comforting, or is it threatening? The reality is, just like it was when we talked last week, is that it's both. Remember the passage that we looked at from Exodus chapter 34, the Lord, the compassionate and gracious God, slow to anger, abounding in love and faithfulness, maintaining love to thousands, and forgiving wickedness, rebellion, and sin. Yet he does not leave the guilty unpunished. He punishes the children and their children for the sin of their parents to the third and fourth generation. God's omniscience is, as always, in the context of his love and his holiness and perfection. And to those who consistently refuse the admonition of the Lord, to those who consistently refuse to submit to God, to those of us who are Christ followers and yet who are persisting in some sinful habit or whatever, then this, his knowledge, his omniscience, can seem like a threat, and it is. It's a little bit like a parent saying, if you steal those cookies from the cookie jar, you're going to have a timeout, you're going to be grounded, you're going to be whatever, right? It is a threat, but it is a threat that is born out of love and out of the desire that people should turn and return to God. So, what does God's omniscience mean for us? Well, first of all, it means very clearly that God is the one being from whom we can hide nothing. We can lie to others until the cows come home. We can even lie to ourselves. We do it so successfully sometimes, but we cannot lie. I mean, we can try, but it's not going to work, right? Take a look at Jonah, right? Remember Jonah? Jonah, he runs away in the opposite direction, trying to avoid God. And God knows exactly where he is and brings him home in the belly of a great fish. Right? Or look at David with his sin with Bathsheba and his sin with Uriah the Hittite. He thought to hide his sin. But then the prophet comes and reveals that God has known all along, and that David's sin is not hidden, but it is clear. So we need to always remember that. We cannot ultimately lie to God. We need to also remember that, you know, those thoughts that we get, right? If people really knew all the terrible, all the evil, the sin and brokenness that is within me, if people really knew that, then they couldn't possibly love me. We need to remember that with God, he does know all those. And he has the highest standards of any being anywhere. God knows all those things, and yet God loves us. thoroughly and fully and with great joy. God loves us completely, even with full knowledge of how desperate our circumstances are. That is incredible, that God loves us, even in spite of everything wrong with us, even in spite of knowing precisely, even better than we do ourselves, he still loves us. But what about our knowledge, limited though it is? What about our knowledge? What does God's omniscience have to do with our knowledge? Well, first of all, we need to recognize that God is really the only one who knows anything. God's knowledge is really complete. Our knowledge is not complete. Never, ever. We don't even know ourselves completely, right? We don't know anything completely. And any knowledge that we do have is derivative. It comes from somewhere else. Our knowledge, ultimately, knowledge of truth, comes from God himself. We don't just create knowledge, whereas with God's knowledge is not derivative. God created all things. He is truth. He is the truth and the way and the life. Right? Not only does God know all the facts, right? God could tell us all the things that scientists don't know yet. God could tell us all the things that lurk in our hearts. God could tell us the reality of past, present, future things. God can tell us all those facts and figures, right? But not only does he know that, he is the only being in all of creation in whom that knowledge that he has is acted upon with absolute consistency, perfect consistency with the truth. Remember how we've talked about how knowledge is not just head knowledge, the facts or whatever, and it's not just heart knowledge, how you feel, right? But it is hands as well, what you do. And with God, head, hands, heart are in perfect synchronicity with the truth, because he is the truth. And so how he behaves is in perfect alignment with the truth. He is the only one who really knows in a way that we cannot even fathom. And therefore, we, because of the reality that God is the only one who really knows, we ought to be extremely humble about anything we think we know. And we ought to be extremely thankful for any knowledge we do have, because ultimately, the truth comes from God. We also need to remember that we need to be cautious about claiming to know things. This has been a tremendous temptation and sin for the church and for Christ followers, and it's not one that I'm exempt from, a tremendous sin to claim to have absolute knowledge where that has proven to be completely incorrect. Throughout the years, we have found out all kinds of things that we thought we had a corner on were just simply not true. We think things, we believe things, we have faith in certain things, but we really, truthfully don't know many things at all. Those things that we do know are revealed by God through one means or another, through the scriptures, through his revelation in prophecies and so on. But really, we have found out so many times that what we thought was true is not. Like slavery. there were many points throughout Christian history where people thought that slavery was perfectly biblical, biblically acceptable. Indeed, slavery was the mandate of heaven for certain populations, that this is how it ought to be. And we know and believe that that is not true now. But we thought we knew it before. Or not other things that are far less important, perhaps, but no less true examples of our lack of knowledge. We thought for years that we should not sing things other than psalms, like from the Bible psalms, the 150 psalms. That's baloney. It's not biblically sound at all, but we believed it very passionately. Or not using instruments other than the organ. or not using instruments at all. John Calvin believed that we should not use any instruments. And further, he also believed that you should not sing in parts, in harmony, because singing in parts and harmony was full of pridefulness. Right? We also believed that our interpretation of the passages where Paul talks about women wearing head coverings, we also believed for many years that that was perfectly, literally applicable exactly as it was written in our own churches, or that women ought to be silent in the church. But now we have seen that those things were not applied correctly for our current situation. And that what Paul wrote there has principles behind it that are still valid, but the application varies from context to context. So we should be very cautious, extremely cautious, about claiming to know things. But that doesn't mean that we don't know anything. What do we know? What do we know? We know the kinds of things that are found in the Apostles' Creed. We know that all truth is derived from He who is the truth, the way, and the life. We know that we are broken and sinful apart from God. We know that God is love. We know that God sent His Son to enact His love in our lives through Jesus, His life, sacrifice, death, and resurrection for us. We know that God sent His Holy Spirit to live within us, to continue the work of sanctifying us. And we know that God inspired His scriptures for us too. And how do we know? How do we know? We know by faith. We know by faith alone in Jesus Christ. We cannot ultimately prove our faith to be true by fact. Or figures, or statistic, or logic, or arguments. If we could, then faith would not really be faith. So what should we, as God's image bearers, do with whatever knowledge we do have? The same thing as God. We use it in love for the good of all. We use it in love for service to God. We use it in love for service to others. And we use it in love to care for the creation that He has given us. The Bible also teaches us very clearly that we should use knowledge for other things as well. We should use it to help us gain wisdom. Proverbs chapter 1, verse 7 says, "The fear of the Lord is the beginning of knowledge, but fools despise wisdom and instruction." Knowledge is something that can give us wisdom. We also know that we should treasure it, especially knowledge about our Lord and Savior, knowledge about God. We should treasure it and look forward to its completion in us. 1 Corinthians 13, verse 12, in there Paul says, "For now we see only a reflection as in a mirror. Then we shall see face to face. Now I know in part, then I shall know fully, even as I am fully known Knowledge is not a bad thing. It is a good thing. And someday, knowledge of God will be made complete in us. And we can look forward to that. What should we not do with our knowledge? Well, number one, we should not use it as a weapon against other people. Against Satan and his lies, yes, absolutely. Against other people, no. Does that mean we should never argue with other people? No, that's not what that means at all. It means that if we argue with other people, if we use our knowledge with other people in debate, in argument with other people, we need to be using that knowledge in a way that is loving, that is good for them and hopefully also for us, a way that is humble, a way that is servant-like, right? We should not use it to puff ourselves up. Paul says in 1 Corinthians chapter 8, verse 1, that knowledge puffs up, but love builds up. Brothers and sisters, God's knowledge is complete. He knows all things, past, present, and future. He knows everything exactly. And he uses his knowledge out of love and out of his holiness and perfection. And as God's image bearers, as limited as our knowledge is, that is what we are called to do too. Let us pray. Father in heaven, thank you so very much for this day. Thank you so very much for your knowledge of us. Lord, indeed, when we have submitted ourselves to you, and when we are totally and completely honest, it is, truth be told, a relief to know that we are intimately and exactly known, and that you love us still. Lord, help us to use the knowledge that we have to grow in wisdom. Help us to gain more knowledge, not to puff ourselves up, but to serve you and to serve others and to care for this world. Help us, O God, to use our knowledge, in short, in the way that you call us you as your image bearers. We pray this all in Jesus' name.